All right.
There you go.
You gonna host this one, or am I gonna host this one?
I don't know. Well, you hosted it last time, so you want to call? You want to do all these earnings calls from this week? Because that's, I mean, we're not even doing a third of the earnings calls we did the videos of, but like.
No, I think I'll host. I'll host.
You want to host?
Yeah, I
don't know if you're good looking enough to be the host. I think.
Really?
You're probably good looking enough.
All right.
I think you're good looking. Right. Keep up the good work.
All right. Well, welcome back to our weekly podcast over at Wall Street Breakdown. This is number two.
Number two. Second podcast.
Yeah.
Talking about money still.
Money.
We haven't moved on to anything crazy yet. There's no B-rated movie reviews, eh? We're still talking about money.
Yeah, we are.
Strange. Why is YouTube so, why is the world missing so many people that seem to want to talk about their finances and try to make more money? So that always baffles me. It's like a conversation I get into with people so rarely. Sort of talking about the stock market, people almost shy away from it like they're scared. It's just numbers.
People right? like more like celebrities and movies and stuff.
Strange. I don't know.
Anyways, let's look at the news for the week of Friday, October 27th. And there was a good, interesting story there, which I thought was the Boeing and Singapore Airlines.
Yeah, you know, like they've got a long track record together, Boeing and Singapore Airlines. Boeing closed the week $256.46 a share. Like Boeing also reported earnings here later on this week on the Wednesday. But this deal is going to be for $13.8 billion. Like I said, these guys have a long track record together. So Singapore Airlines, obviously, you know, we're talking about one of the more affluent places in the world. So there's a lot of money to go around. So they've already got 30 Dreamliners, 30 of the 787-10 Dreamliners, which, I mean, Boeing only makes 18 of those a month. So in this order, this $13.8 billion order, they got 20 777-9s and 19 787-10 Dreamliners. And like I said, they already have 30 of those. So this deal could actually reach up to 51 planes in total. But as we go further on into Boeing's backlog, I would imagine that like a lot of these planes for delivery is going to be, it's going to be a while. The 777-9s are going to get there a lot quicker than the 787-10 Dreamliners, right? So, but yeah, that's another just big deal for Boeing. I think we're just covering it again because it just goes to show, like last week we had Bombardier and Airbus do this little C-Series deal and whatever. I mean, it's going to get Delta their planes. And it got Airbus a good portion of that C-Series program for next to nothing. I mean, Bombardier is basically just trying to make their money back. I think it's stay afloat. But then you go the following week after Boeing basically says a couple of, you know, like state-funded companies. And Boeing just does another big deal. Just boom, here's a big deal. We'll call earnings in a couple of days. That's a big one. So just, I like Boeing. They got a lot of swagger. Boeing's a good way to start. They're their biggest gainer on the Dow this year for a reason, right? They're a good way to start off, off a podcast.
So what's going on with that Amazon headquarters deal?
Well, we talked about that last week, right? Everybody thought there was going to be about 100 different cities that were going to be on the front lines for trying to get this Amazon headquarters number two. But as it turns out, 238. So, I mean, when you talk about something that's going to cost $5 billion to build and potentially over the next 20 years could add 50,000 jobs to your city, you know, like that is a lot. So, I mean, it's a big deal. And like I've said before, I think Amazon probably with their second headquarters is going to go, they're going to go probably above and beyond, I would imagine.
Oh, like,
first one, great. But second one, when you're balling, like you look at Bezos, like Bezos isn't like some guy who looks like he's like goofing around. Like he's yoked.
Oh,
like
yeah.
Bezos is not just your run-of-the-mill nerd anymore, right? So, I mean, he's got some dough. Amazon's finally doing good these last few years. Like we're like turning over like real earnings, like not just rev, but earnings. Like they're getting into a lot of stuff. This headquarters is going to be, I would imagine this is going to be unreal. So it'd be cool to see where this finally ends up being. But, I mean, we talked about this last week where we think it could be potentially, but I know all bets are off. I think they're going somewhere big, but they're going to go somewhere where they can put their imprint on things as well. So 238 bids, we heard it was 100. So that's quite a bit.
Well, you used the keyword earnings, and boy, is this podcast full of earnings.
Earnings, buddy.
Let's look at T-Mobile's earnings.
T-Mobile earnings per share 63 cents, beat the street by 17, revenues of $10.02 billion. That's in line with the street, but that's up 7.6% year over year. Their net income at T-Mobile is up 50% year over year with 1.3 million net additions. T-Mobile is killing it. I mean, T-Mobile's killing it, right? Like, how could they not be? I would imagine this T-Mobile Sprint deal is right around the corner. I mean, T-Mobile and Sprint both announced they did earnings both this week. Back to back, actually, Sprint on Tuesday. We're not really covering that. It wasn't the greatest earnings call, but T-Mobile, great earnings call, like usual. Growing company, just unbelievable. This merger is going to be really good for both of those companies. I think it's really going to help prop up Sprint. Sprint is not doing as well, despite being quite a bit bigger than T-Mobile. T-Mobile's allowed a little more leeway in the marketplace to try to gain some market share. The FCC allows a little bit of that, but T-Mobile, again, with great earnings call, very impressive. I'm not too sure who's going to win out more, Sprint or T-Mobile, by the actual merger, but once they finally get all this stuff settled and it all goes through, and like, neither company gave guidance. They both are under the impression that this is happening for sure, so there was no forward guidance given. Both these companies they're going to make each other a hell of a lot better. 62.95 is what T-Mobile ended the week at, and that is pretty much what happened on Monday, a typical Monday where... there's just not that much news on a Monday.
No, it's slow.
You get into the Monday Fridays, man. I think people made their money this week during those days. But the Tuesday to Thursday. Let's get on with earnings. What do we got? 20 of them?
Yeah, so we're gonna look at Tuesday, October 24th. The first one we're gonna look at for earnings is Helio and Matheson.
Oh no, this isn't earnings, right? Helios and Matheson this is just news. The Helios Matheson closed week 10.74, been really up and down, up high 20s. It's been really pulled back. This news came out, they were higher than this, so this news really didn't resonate. I think a lot of people made their money on this. We've talked about this enough, kind of pulled their money out of it. But they did announce that the MoviePass subscription service went from 20,000 subscriptions in August to 600,000, I think it was October 18th they announced that number, or that number was taken from. So that is significant growth at $9.95 a month. But, I mean, we heard Regal come out with their earnings call earlier, like this week as well, and Regal said in their earnings call that they weren't planning on sharing any concessions or admission money with MoviePass. I mean, that doesn't bode really well for MoviePass. I mean, like I said, it's a great niche idea. People want to go to the movies, sure. They don't have a very big turnover right now. I think their customer retention for subscriptions is like 96% or something, which is excellent. At the moment, when it's new, it's very, very niche. It's very, very new. Will this last for a couple of years? I don't know. But Helios and Matheson own a pretty big chunk of this MoviePass. It's over 50%. It's definitely a controlling interest. They made money. They jumped up. I think even Helios and Matheson, if they were smart, all disclosure out there, I think they should have took their money off the table. And I said that when they were up in the higher 20s. So, good story, good growth, MoviePass. I know a lot of people are rooting for it, and it's been moving around quite a bit, but it doesn't seem like the market as a whole is in on it anymore. They let it run, they took their money, and now I think everybody's a little trepidatious to touch it until they see that it can actually make a little bit of an earning.
All
right. Now you can start with the earnings for
15. Yeah, sorry, I got that mixed up, so my bad. Caterpillar, how was their earnings?
Excellent. I mean, unbelievable. There is no, we talk about Boeing being a darling on the Dow. Caterpillar is just unbelievable. So like significant growth in China. EPS $1.95 beat the street by 68 cents. That EPS number was only 85 cents last year. Revenues of $11.4 billion. That beat the street by $770 million. That's up 24.5% year over year. They upped their guidance. I mean, they're stellar. Everything Cat's doing, the construction end, everything is growing. It's a well-run company. It's expensive. $137.81 it closed the week at. It's expensive. There's just no two ways around how much it would cost to get into Cat now. But if you're in Cat, I'm sure you're very, very happy owning it, because the world's building and Caterpillar is that number one brand name still. It's still the...
Well, everybody knows it.
Oh my god, I mean, honestly, right? Like, there's
right now I'm wearing a Caterpillar hoodie.
Yeah, exactly.
So, let's how about United Technologies?
So yeah, big defense company, doing great again. Earnings per share, $1.73, beat the street by 5 cents. Revenues of $15.45 billion, beat the street by $470 million. That's up 6.3% year over year. A lot of the divisions doing well. Everything basically up. Pratt and Whitney up 10%. They closed the week $119.07. And I mean, it's just, you take a look at a lot of these defense contractor companies. They're amazing. They generate so much revenue in an up economy when governments have a little bit of money to spread around, because the United States government is always in this arms race, right? So I mean, United Technologies is one of those companies that just, they benefit so much from the contracts that they get to sign, that they're on such a short list of other companies that are vying for these contracts, because there's only 5 or 6 companies in the world that can actually facilitate a lot of these government contracts that are there, right? So United Technologies, Lockheed Martin, Halliburton, Northrop Grumman, Raytheon, Boeing, there are not a lot of companies out there that can do these kind of things. They are afforded a lot of good stuff. It's an up economy. They're a strong, strong company, well-run company, good earnings call. Licensed professional financial advisor would be my best advice to anybody. But yeah, this is, some of these earnings calls this week are earnings calls that I would think would let people know that the United States' prosperity is not waning at all. So yeah, United Technologies, good earnings.
Let's look at another defense company, Lockheed Martin.
Okay, I'm going to have some Undertaker water. Lockheed Martin earnings per share, $3.24, missed by 2 cents. Revenues at $12.17 billion, missed by $640 million, but that's up 5.4% year over year. Aeronautics segment up 14%. They upped their guidance. A bunch of the segments were up. They're not near as much as the aeronautics, but still up, up, up. I mean, the revenue number up 5.4%. They missed a couple of things, but I mean, EPS of $3.24 a share. I mean, that's, yeah, Lockheed Martin again, just stellar. You're basically, you choose your winner as far as a lot of these companies go when it comes to companies like some of these. Like, you really get to take a look and just say, like, who do I prefer based on what they touch in other sectors? Because a lot of these companies do so much stuff that break off into a few other things, and they're not 100% all the same.
Oh, right, yeah.
So then you talk about, well, like, what else do I own that maybe is close to this? Because I would like to, you know, you could take your pick of United Technologies, a Lockheed Martin, a Raytheon, and Northrop Grumman. You're probably never going to really be too bummed out. These companies are strong, well-run companies. Lockheed Martin with a great earnings call. This is the pick of the litter this week. It's unbelievable. Just when you're looking at the list of people who have earnings this week, what we're still going to get to, what we've already covered, it's pretty good. It's the who's who of the American economy.
Who's who? Okay, let's look at McDonald's earnings.
There you go, right? Like, I mean, is there anything else on every corner of the free world than McDonald's? Earnings per share of $1.76, missed the street by a penny. Revenues of $5.75 billion, beat the street by $10 million. But that revenue number is down 10.4% year over year. The thing is McDonald's has comparable store sales up not only domestically but internationally. And overall throughout the whole company, the domestic store sales, same-store sales are up 6%. So McDonald's driving traffic. So some of the revenue number is down. That's definitely something that people are a little bit concerned with. I mean, people have been concerned with McDonald's and driving traffic for a while now, right? And McDonald's is really trying to streamline their business and going back to what they were known for and getting away from some of the stuff that maybe was helping them to expand their horizons but lose their identity, maybe you could say. So McDonald's, I think it was still a pretty good earnings call from a company that's turning the business back into what it originally was, which was a burger and fry shop. And McDonald's is a really good company that's everywhere. It's really tough to argue with. The comparable store sales up 6% throughout the whole company. Ended the week $165.39. Not a shabby company at all. As far as the food sector goes, it's probably the best earnings call we've seen so far, but there's still some stuff to come. So, but I still like the McDonald's call. I definitely do.
Moving on to Pulte Group, how they do?
Oh yeah, I mean the housing builders are doing so good in the United States. Earnings per share of 60 cents, beat the street by one. $2.13 billion. That missed by $170 million, but up by 9.8% year over year. Their average selling price is up 7%. Their new orders are up 11%. Their backlog is up 15%. They closed the week 30.07. But I mean, Pulte Group is definitely one of the top end housing builders in the United States. And when you're going to talk about who's really going to set the bell, set the bar, the guys that are going to let you know how it's going, then these guys always report first. They're getting it off the table like usual. I mean, we've been seeing this quarter after quarter out of a lot of the builders. I mean, when you look at the average selling price is up and new orders are up, I mean, it's pretty tough to really say, whoa, what could you be doing wrong?
You're
selling things for more and you're selling more of them. Like, man.
You're not going wrong there, right?
What else are you trying to do in business, right? Sounds like you're making a pretty good product that's got quite a bit of demand. So I'm really looking forward to the rest of the home builders. I've said before, I think home builders are really important as far as where the economy's headed. You get to see a real base level of what people are willing to spend out there.
Yeah.
I mean, we've seen stuff bounce around up here in Toronto and Vancouver this year. I mean, you could see stuff move around. You could see how an economy, like in a vacuum, just in Toronto, could get jarred by things, and all of a sudden you get these drastic pullbacks. And in the United States, Pulte Group covers a big amount of square footage. We haven't seen any pullbacks. We're seeing a nice gradual increase, even as credit seems to get a little more available, maybe you'd say, or, you know, credit's out there to be had. We're not seeing the defaults come up yet. Pulte Group, good earnings call.
Yeah, they had a decent earnings call. So let's move on to 3M.
Ah, that's the big. That's the other big one on the cap from this day. That was the one that was the real mover from that Dow. The Dow, I think, hit an all-time high that day. It was up like 138 points. It was a big Tuesday. 3M EPS was 233. That beat the street by 12 cents. Revenues of 8.17 billion. That beat the street by 240 million. And that's up 6% revenue year over year. They upped their guidance, their organic sales growth. And I mean, organic sales growth at 3M to be up is significant as it is, up 6.6%. Closed the week at $234.74. 3M's a strong company. I mean, it's expensive to own, but if you own it already, you're fine. There's no risk, right? Like, I mean, there's risk. Don't get me wrong. There's always risk, but I mean, you're not out on a limb. Yeah.
One of my favorite companies coming up next is GM.
Really? Wow, they suck. Yeah. That's a terrible
joke. I know.
Merry men over at GM. They've put all the planes away. There's no more planes for the board of directors. And, I mean, GM's just trying to figure it out. So, earnings per share of $1.32. Beat the street by 19 cents. Revenues of $33.62 billion. That beat the street by $950 million. But that's down 13.6% year over year. Their operating cash flow it was $1.1 billion versus $6.1 billion a year ago. $44.64 it ends the week at. It's a terrible company. I mean, they're just... Yeah, that's... You go take a look at this earnings call. You take a look at this company just as a whole. It's just not even... It's a shell of its former self. It's a sad state of affairs. They're trying to figure this out. They're going to cut the dividend. They're going to cut the dividend for the third time only in 125 years. It's going to crush this stock. The stock is going to drop. Yeah, it's going to crush it. Like, people are going to jump off the stock so fast because, I mean, all it is a dividend stock. It's not going anywhere. It's a loser, right? Like, this company needs to figure out how to get some operating cash flow and make some moves. Like, GM has no choice but to try to figure it out. So it's time to show and prove. So they better... Whatever hand they got to play, they've got to play it, and they're going to have to just eat whatever the share price goes down to when they do ultimately cut this dividend, because I think that's what they're going to end up doing.
Yeah. All right, closing out Tuesday, let's look at Capital One's earnings.
Yeah, not a bad earnings call. EPS at 242, beat the street by 27 cents. So, I mean, that looks really substantial. Revenues of $6.99 billion, beat the street by $180 million. That's up 8.2%. So, like, the revenue number, 8.2% up year over year is nice. But you take that earnings per share number and take a look at it, 28 cents from the Cabela's deal and some restructuring. So they already knew that money was in there. It was a decent enough earnings call. I threw it in because, you know, we didn't really have any other financials this week that really reported anything. There was basically Capital One and Visa, right? So we got Visa on here too. But I just threw it on there. It's just financials are still doing good. I mean, in every avenue from the PayPal companies to the Capital Ones and MasterCards and Visas and all that, all the way to the banks, the asset managers. I mean, we're just trying to keep honing in on how well the United States is doing, and that you've got so many options right now with how well all the sectors are doing. that it really, really, really is a buyer's market still, I think, because there's just no pullbacks anywhere. We need people to actually go out and do the due diligence and find where the missing money is, because there's definitely companies that have money that they're owed in a market where we've raised, like, let's face it, we've raised, like, the trailing price, the earnings and stuff in a lot of segments, a lot of sectors, fairly significantly. Things have changed, right? We let price to book and stuff get a little more out of hand when economies are doing so well, and that's fine. But there's companies out there that haven't been afforded that same thing yet. So when we want to touch on the fact that companies across every different sector seem to be doing well enough that it warrants you at least taking notice and doing the research and taking a look. Because when you just talk about, like, Helios and Matheson from earlier on the Tuesday there, what they did in the last couple of weeks and the money that was made there, okay, granted, that's kind of speculative and I don't want people to invest that way. If you're paying attention to stuff like that, if you're really quick, if you're really smart, and if you can stay on it, I mean, over the course of a few weeks, there was a pretty big fluctuation. There is money to be made there, but it's a matter of understanding that the market needs you to be 100% all in mentally. You need to be active in the market, because there's always some quantitative analysis going on a computer in some giant $100 billion room that's trying to find that missing penny somewhere in a share price. Yeah. You have to use foresight, like a human ability of foresight, to be able to go in and crack that code. And I'm not saying it's good to go out and chase the money around. It's good to be safe. But in an economy like this where everything still seems to be up and you have your ability to almost pick what you like, if you pick smart enough, I would say research, research, research. Why not, when you've got options, use your options.
And the research is widely available.
Yeah, oh, it's so wide. Like, there's so many mediums for research. I think that for people not doing it, for people leaving everything in their financial advisor's hands and completely being hands-off with whatever they're investing in, I think is a mistake. You're not hands-off with your job. You're not hands-off with how you make your money to begin with.
You know? Why would you this, be hands this off is, with your money?
This is the more fun part. Yeah. This is the part where you get to watch, you know, hundreds of billions of dollars move around every day in the capital markets. And if you're somebody who's got a real keen eye and a good instinct, you can find money out there because you invest properly. And you can do some real damage. You'll do more damage doing this than you will with your paper out, you know, or whatever
sure.
your career is, right? Like, this is where the real money is, the after-hours money, that if you can allocate the proper amount of money out of your normal paycheck and put it into actively managing your own money over the course of time and be relatively good at it, because you're relatively well-versed, you do the research or whatever, and then on top of that, be a little bit lucky, yeah, this is where the money is, yeah.
Right on. Let's move along to Wednesday, October 25th for earnings calls.
So, again, Boeing, we talked about on the Monday, the earnings per share, $2.72, beat the street by 6 cents. Revenues of $24.3 billion, beat the street by $380 million. That's up 1.7% year over year. They booked 117 new net orders for planes. 5,700 planes are currently in the backlog with a value of $474 billion. We talked about the Singapore Airlines deal earlier. They make nothing but moves. Boeing is a monster. I mean, it's just, it's so expensive right now. Like, I would not advise going near Boeing at this point. If I was just telling you what to invest in, unless you were getting it indexed already in, and you're just getting a touch of it anyways at the price that it's at. But, I mean, it's so much because it's gone. It just does so many things that people they're endeared to it. It trades at like 24 times earnings, and it's like in its history in the last like 5 years of really good economy still, it only traded at like 16 times earnings. So I mean, it's trading at a significant multiple. It's a darling. I mean, people love, if you own Boeing and you haven't taken some money off the table, like, shame on you, right? Like, but if you're in Boeing, you should, I mean, I would be happy to be there, but to advise someone to get into something that's just so topped out, no matter how good it is, I mean, I don't know, it's, you would really have to be in love with it. I mean, how could you not be in love with the company? But I mean, you'd have to really be in love with the idea of investing, even at the number value that it is right now. Hell of an earnings call, though. Excellent, like usual for Boeing.
I can't get enough of saying this company's name for this earning call. Northrop Grumman.
Big defense company. Yeah. Earnings per share of $3.68, beat the street by 76 cents. Revenues of $6.53 billion, beat the street by $200 million. That's up 6% year over year. A lot of segments up. Aerospace, the big one, up 11%. Northrop closed the week $297.66. Brother, it's just, like I said earlier, it's your pick. You just decide how you want to be in it. You want to be in defense. I mean, in the United States, when things are ripping, you got a Republican government. I mean, we know the history. If you don't know history, you're damned to repeat it. So to pretend that things might be different, things always kind of are going to gravitate more towards that their polarizing effect. And, you know, it's going to be one of those things where defense companies do kind of thrive under Republican government a little more. And that's fine. I don't really dispute the allocation of funds over to that. But I definitely, as an advisor, would say, like, hey, the defense sector as a whole is something to always keep an eye on because they're always strong companies. But right now, given where we are North Korea-wise, all the stuff we've talked about over the last couple of months, I would say a defense company, if you don't have one in your portfolio, especially if you're individually allocated, like you've got five or six companies, you don't own baskets anything, you're super diversified, like five or six individual companies, to not have something out of the American defense sector, I think is kind of, you're leaving a little money on the table probably, but that's just my opinion. Licensed professional financial advisor, go ahead and do that one.
Let's take a look at one of the world's biggest beverage companies, Coca-Cola.
Yeah, the biggest. I mean, that's the biggest. I mean, maybe Anheuser-Busch InBev, like maybe, but I think Coke's probably,
it's probably on the top.
For the one beverage, for the one thing that knocks out all the money, yeah, for sure. Coca-Cola EPS of 50 cents, beat the street by one. Revenue of $9.08 billion, beat the street by $240 million, but that's down 14.6% year over year. Organic revenue's up 4%. Coca-Cola closed the week at $46.07. It was not a great earnings call, but when you compare it to the other companies out there still, we had a Dr. Pepper Snapple earnings call this week. Was not near as good as this. Pepsi, we know from their previous earnings calls, nowhere near what Coke is. So Coke's still in that segment, runs. They run it. So, I mean, if you're in that segment, I don't think you're going to be too upset owning Coke because they're still the best of breed. But the earnings call as a standalone, just to take a look at it, it's not blowing anybody out of the water. But, I mean, Coca-Cola still in that individual segment where you're comparing them with Pepsi and Monster and all those other companies, still the best. Absolutely the best.
Oh, absolutely the best. How did Visa do on their earnings call?
Good, like usual. Credit's up, so people are borrowing money. Everybody's doing well. Everybody wants to spend money. You know, you get yourself a nice Louis Vuitton bag or something. So Visa's EPS 90 cents, beat the street by 5 cents. Revenues of $4.86 billion, beat the street by $230 million. That's up 14.1% year over year. Total process transactions up 13%. Payment volume growth up 10%. Visa closed the week at $109.71, and I mean, everything is up. This is where we're concerned. Like, when we do talk about credit card companies, they're going to be some of the first ones that we're going to see defaults.
Like,
when an economy does turn, and it will turn, because, like, right now, I would say lending is probably on a curve very close to what the growth is for the economy. And the economy, like when we talk about the stock market or the amount of money in the economy, is growing at a pretty decent clip. And I would say lending is probably right close there. So when we see the first one start to pull back, lending won't pull back till a little bit later. Like it'll be a little behind the trend. And then you'll see defaults. Interest rates will go up. Lending will get pulled back. People will need more money, but they're over leveraged. And you'll end up. So Visa's doing good now, but I mean, Visa, MasterCard, Amex, if anybody's out there thinking that, like, the country of the United States is not going to be as affluent or the stock market's going to have a pullback, those would be the things that would bother me as an economic pullback. You start to see defaults. So these companies have run high. Visa, Amex, they're doing really, really well, but they're doing really well on borrowed money, borrowed time, borrowed both.
Something like that, yeah. Let's look at Thursday, October 26th earning calls. Let's start with Microsoft.
More huge companies, eh? Yeah. How are all these companies reporting earnings? How is this not the leadoff on the main news?
These companies
that do everything in the world
Everybody uses some sort of Microsoft program on Windows.
Earnings per share, 84 cents, beat the street by 12 cents. Revenues of $24.58 billion beat the street by $980 million. That's up 11.9% year-over-year. Microsoft still, I mean, with a revenue number growing at a 12% clip, I mean, it's tough to bet against Microsoft. Intelligent Cloud revenue up 13%. I know their cloud, they had a goal for their cloud system to go over $20 billion in revenue for 2017, and they've already crossed that. So productivity of business processes up 28%. It was a monster quarter for Microsoft, just proving once again that, like, as the trends change, that's a company that can change with the trends. This isn't one of those companies we talk about that have spread themselves too thin and went down, like, 50 different rabbit holes, like, all in. They know when to pull back on one thing that they're overextended on, that the marketplace is starting to say, like, we don't need as much of that, and to readjust enough that they just slide into new segments. Like, Microsoft's a gangster. Heck of a company.
Now, it's kind of sad to report these next earnings from Mattel.
Oh, they at least bounced back from. They were down. They stopped trading on Mattel after this earnings call, because in after hours, they were down like 27% at one point. They didn't fall that much throughout the whole week. But EPS at 9 cents, missed by 50 cents. Revenues of $1.56 billion, missed by $260 million. That's down 13.3% year over year. They got the Toys R Us thing. They've got the American Girls line is dying. Fisher Price is dying. I mean, there's no shipments going to Toys R Us really at all. So, like, all the stuff has been pulled back just drastically, right? So, Mattel closed the week at $14. It could have been way worse. It could have been so much worse. Yeah. The House of Barbie is in such shambles. Like,
oh, it is.
Barbie's a disheveled mess. She's a mess at this point. Clean yourself up, Barbie. Yeah, Mattel's got to handle your business, Mattel. You got to figure something else out, because it's not working what they're doing right now. They were way too, for this quarter, just to be this drastic. I mean, only imagine when Toys R Us goes away, like, how important Toys R Us was to Mattel's business and what that's going to do if they're already just withering on the vine. We'll see. Mattel's got some iconic brands. We'll give them that. They might be able to turn this around, but we'll see.
Let's look at another car manufacturer here. Let's look at Ford.
Huh, Ford, yeah. Again, another big American manufacturer. Closed the week at $12.06. Ford's been making slight increases in that share price over years. Their compact car segment's not very good. We know that. They've closed down plants in Mexico and stuff on a couple of different things for 3 weeks at a time just to slow down production so they don't get too much overstock. But, like, their SUV segments are doing really well. So are their truck segments. They're definitely the leader in the American brands that are selling stuff. Earnings per share, 43 cents. Beat the street by 10 cents. Revenues of $33.65 billion. Beat the street by $850 million. That's up 1% in revenue. Operating margins of 5%. They've got lower material costs. Ford is just, they're trying to streamline their business as best as they can and really gear up for what the customer wants and not try to just spread themselves out and try to make everything. They know that there's a few things they do that they do really well that the customers really like, and they're really, really focusing in on that. And the stuff that's really kind of falling by the wayside, they're doing it, but they're doing it at a very, very minor level in comparison. They know their SUVs and trucks rock socks. They know They know that. People want what Ford puts out in those big utility vehicles and the trucks. It's not the same for their smaller cars. And Ford knows that. So Ford's doing what's smart. And, I mean, you're seeing it in earnings calls. Yeah, it's a good earning call from an American auto manufacturer.
So everybody knows their ABCs. So let's check out Alphabet's
earnings calls. Yeah, Google. Earnings per share of $9.57, beat the street by $1.28. I mean, revenue at $27.8 billion, beat the street by $600 million. That revenue number is up 23.8% year over year. Ad revenue up 23%. Aggregate paid clicks on Google is up 47%. Google is,
that's huge.
They're huge. Unbelievable. You want to know how big of a company Alphabet is? Alphabet's such a big company, they've got one segment they just call other revenue, and other revenue was up 40%. That sounds like one dude with a mop in a room with no lights on is working like an old Rolodex with an old phone, you know, he's in there trying to figure out how to make some money. He's like, oh, I'm up 40%. Like, all I do is call. It says Alphabet on their caller ID, and they immediately take me me seriously. I'm up 40% in this sector over here. That's unreal. They're an unbelievable company. They're moving into Toronto. You heard that, eh? They're making digital city thing in Toronto on the waterfront. It's
this would be interesting.
It's going to end up being like a tourist attraction, right?
Oh, for sure.
Like, it sounds like what they're going to do is they're going to have all of their good stuff that they're working on, their research and development, available for people to kind of look at, like...
Kind of test it.
Yeah, through, like, a glass, watching scientists at work, kind of, right? Yeah, so, cool. Alphabet closed the week, $1,000.19 that's just sharing. It's, I don't know. You're going to have a hard time finding anything wrong with... company. YouTube. I love you guys. I love you guys. We love Alphabet. They're fantastic. So expensive to own, but fantastic.
Up next, it looks like we have Time Warner.
Oh, soon to be AT&T Time Warner,
soon
right?
Soon to be,
Earnings per share of $1.82. Beat the street by 23 cents. Revenues of $7.6 billion. Beat the street by $210 million. That's up 6%. HBO had its highest quarterly growth in 13 years.
Wow.
Time Warner actually had a really good quarter. For a lot of TV being pulled back, Time Warner has a lot of brands that people still really, really gravitate towards. So Time Warner is really, they're doing really well in comparison to a lot of their competitors right now. Closed the week at $98.79, and we've talked about this merger with AT&T. It is going to be huge. They are going to become some sort of super conglomerate where they, I would imagine, control the media. Yeah, I don't know how else to put it.
Yeah, especially when you get to that point. Another name I like to say is Raytheon.
Oh, my. Yeah, another one. These guys got great stuff. EPS of $1.97, beat the street by 6 cents. Revenue of $6.3 billion, missed by $30 million, but that's up 4.5% year over year. Raytheon closed the week at $180.28. They raised their guidance during their earnings call, but I think most importantly is to take a look at some of their segments and how they break down, and most of their segments are doing really well, but the segment doing the best, and probably the most fun segment, and I imagine it's probably ran by like Rambo, is their missile system segment, up 9.9%. Yeah, I want a segment in a company just where missiles. Some guy's working on missiles. Just not missiles to hurt anybody.
Well,
I just
get to that.
I just want to have a really cool title like that. That just sounds so important. You think you think guys in that part of the business, like actually that's just like, hi, I'm Dave Smith, missile systems expert. Like you got like a business card.
Yeah.
It's got like a missile on it. You know, like
you think there's a lot of chicks out there? Missile expert here.
Does a bear in the woods? I mean,
I guess,
think, bro? Like, if not, I think you'd be able to at least get a lot of fans of other dudes. Like, a missile systems expert?
Yeah.
Buy this guy a drink. There you go. Raytheon, good company, good earnings call, another strong defense company. They got segments called missile systems. That in and of itself. That's awesome.
That finishes the news for Thursday. Let's look at Friday, October 27th. There's a pretty good story here. Let's talk about the Apple iPhone X pre-order.
Yeah, so I mean, everybody thought the iPhone wasn't doing good. The 8, the 8 Plus, people weren't impressed. It was a lot of the 8 Plus started to pick up in sales a little bit, right? So like going into this, people thought, you know, Apple's, they don't have the OLEDs. We're not going to have the numbers to be able to push this out. They've already pushed this back. Like, they felt like it was pushed back already, right? Like, this phone should have been released with the other phones. But people were waiting. People were waiting with their money. Real Apple fans were waiting with their money. The sales opened at 12 a.m. Pacific on Friday, and in 30 minutes, there were no more phones available for the November 3rd launch. And as of right now, where we stand, it's a six-week wait after November 3rd to get a phone. So, like, people came out in droves that wanted the iPhones.
They want
this phone bad. So, Apple, that's a big coup going into the Christmas season. Let's see if they can actually fill all these orders. That's what people have kind of been wondering to begin with. Can they fill the orders? But, big coup for Apple. I mean, Apple, people want this iPhone X, and that's it's tough to argue with. It's a great company that makes great smartphones despite being third in the world. Closed the week at $163.05. Apple is going into the weekend looking really good. This is a good look for them. That's big sales.
That is big sales, yeah. Let's close up this podcast with one more earnings call. Let's look at
one more. I could have done more.
Oh, there's so much more.
Oh, Exxon Mobil earnings per share of 93 cents beat the street by 7 cents. Revenue of $66.2 billion beat the street by $2.81 billion. That's up 12.8% in revenue year over year. Their upstream segment is up. Downstream is up. The chemicals were down a little bit, minus 1%. They closed the week at 83.71. It was a heck of a good earnings call from one of the biggest companies in the world, Exxon. It was a magnificent week for earnings, period. I was overtly impressed. I am a firm believer that we are far, far from the end of what is a surging economy. Yeah, if you're not in the marketplace now, I don't know what you've been waiting for. I think a lot of us have been watching this go on for a really long period of time at this point. You just don't see prosperity like this more than maybe once a generation. And right. It's still going strong. These earnings calls just keep telling me that it is still, it's probably going to be going strong right through the end of 2017. The only thing that's going to really back anybody off is going to be too much trepidation. Like, people are going to start overthinking it, thinking the market's overbought. You know, like, that's going to be the big issue, is human error. It's not that these companies aren't performing. These companies keep getting bigger and bigger expectations because of right. bigger and bigger share prices. And they just keep coming out with bigger and bigger quarterly earnings. So, I mean, it's not the companies that are doing it. It's going to be the contrarians in the marketplace that scare themselves away and start saying, oh, it's a top, it's a plateau, it's about right, to yeah. fall. Like, personally, you see all this stuff and you go, like, bound to fall. If anything, I see steady. Like, I see a very, very firm, steady foundation of companies that, at the top of all segments, look quite robust and strong. They don't look like they're just about to let it all go.
No, they don't.
So, yeah, I was impressed. This was a heck of a week of earnings. This was podcast number two.
Number two.
Anthony, you hosted again.
I did.
You hosted again.
I had fun. Next week too, I think.
I'm Cody from Wall Street Breakdown.
I'm Anthony from Wall Street Breakdown.
We had a good time. We hope you had a good time. We will be back tomorrow, Monday. It's time to get back to work. There's more earnings this week. Yeah, we will see you tomorrow.
Check you later.